His team's on 10, big show, a dashing saint with a mullet is on the couch. We get to the bottom of why goal kicking is so bad, and talking of bad, we're back on the golf course. Teams on 10, Nick Butler alongside the former Blue and John, and now he's like the CP3, Chris Paul of all things social media. It took you a while to get there, but now you're starring and you're little and we love you.
Yeah, we do. How are you, Nicky, my friend? Sorry I couldn't be here last week, obviously an RDO, and heard the ratings took a bit of a hit, but I'm back.
We're back on Teams on 10. Pretty good show without you.
And, I heard that heard they've just culled it and took it off air.
Don't take a holiday, my boy, but it's great to have you back. Tomo was good. He cut me off a few times.
Yeah, he was good.
That's what he does. And Waleed was very good.
Yes, I was chatting with Waleed out earlier. He loves his Tigers.
No. So great show, but great to have you back. You are the star of the show.
I know that.
Pump myself up a little bit, but I'm easily replaced and you're not.
Now, that's true.
Quickly.
That's very true.
I don't like pumping up your podcast because you're making millions from it and all that sort of stuff, but you've got Gorney on this week. That excites me.
Yeah, Gorney, Max Gorney. He was incredible. Obviously a very lovable character, very open, very honest. He's just a funny guy, but he was exactly like he is in person. In reality, in person. So I'd love to have my chat with him. And he was a big fan of yours as well.
Fair dinkum. What did he say?
Oh, I just said he just loves your work.
That's okay. Well, I love his work. I thought when he got drafted, he was like a bit of a hipster doofus kind of cat, but his footy has really won me over. But the story I love most, and this is a bit of a furfy, unbelievable tale that we're getting in early here, is the old data, the old on the way to training. So Maxi Gorn was having a durry in the car with the windows down on the way to training, and he got busted by a teammate. I think it's one of the great stories, and we're going to roll it now.
Would love a party dart as a 17-year-old.
Yeah.
I mean, I think most people did. Well, I thought most people did.
Yeah.
Apparently, people who wanted to be footballers didn't. But and as I was driving down to Casey, I looked in the back seat and there was a deck of darts there. And I just thought, why not?
Yeah.
And I lit up a dart, and albeit Carl Cheney was on the Monash Freeway as well. And I didn't see him. So he saw me and I didn't see him, which would have been great because I would have had both windows down.
Yeah.
And he would have just been, I can only imagine what his look would have been. Just like, just staring at me going, what is that bloke doing?
So Kyle Cheney's, was he put him in? Is he put him in for having a bunger?
I think he's dividobbed.
I should stop doing that.
Yeah, stop doing that. I think he's dividobbed, which it's not promoted, but I think in that case it's fair enough.
You know, as a skipper, though, what a great story to tell the young scallywags that come in and you can say, look, boys, you know, I know that you want to do this and that. I've been there. I got busted having a dart at training. Mm. What do you call it?
Relatable.
It's connection. That's the millennial word I was looking for. Relatable.
I think that's why he is such a good captain and why his leadership is so good, is he is relatable and he has been at every spectrum of the list. He's been nearly delisted. He's been dropped. He's been captain. He's played for a bottom team. Now he's playing for a premiership contender. It gives him like a uni degree in life and in footy. So that's why I really think he is a great captain. And he says, everyone around him says, the emotional intelligence he has to connect with all the players on the list is second to none.
Good one. You're on fire.
Thank
you. Got your juices flowing after round 16?
Okay, so juices this week, a big, big week. And I love this time of year. It gets a little bit cold. Winter is there in Victoria.
Morale's down.
Morale is down. So what happens? We spike it up. The long sleeve comes out. I was always a big fan of this, especially in the AFL.
Not the double up.
The double up, the long sleeve, we loved it. A few players here that do it quite regularly, but even Fifey had it on. Joshy Bruce has been one that's wearing it. There's a couple of Essendon boys wearing it. The Geelong boys are loving it. Brad Close there, he's loving it. But it is great. I do love this style of footy. But the one thing that does annoy me a little bit with it is if you're going to wear it, commit to the long sleeve.
Yes.
I don't want you rolling it up to a T-shirt. I don't want it to be a three-quartery. So make sure you wear it fully down. Otherwise, it just gets a little bit strange for my liking.
Coaches, Alistair Clarkson, we'll ask you about that in a moment. So a bit of news with Clarkson. He hated the long sleeves. The Hawks don't wear them.
Yeah.
Except Tucky.
Yeah, and that's fair enough. I don't mind it, but I also think as well, it's funny with the long sleeve. You have to be a specific type of player to wear it. I don't think you can wear it if you haven't got the runs on the board, that's for sure.
Ruckman wearing them?
Wouldn't have
Stephen
thought
King. So. Stephen no, King. Wouldn't have thought no, no, good one. I like it. Well, mine. I've got a juice. Joel Amati is my juice. So I tuned in the Swans game. The Swans are amazing, and I hadn't watched this kid play. And I'm like, who is this lad? 36. He's big, a bit mummy-like in his presence and follow-up. Then he started taking clunks. He uses the ball well. Look at that beautiful kick out into advantage side. I don't know if that was the one. That's a big contested mark. I thought, now is this another academy kid? You know, they're just banking him. The Swans had a look into it. Second round rookie pick from Bo Morris.
Unbelievable.
I reckon he's going to be a star.
Yeah.
Little furfy, unbelievable. We're at the Como here in South Yarra. Swans are next door. About half an hour ago, rocked down a grill for a burger. There's Joel. I said g'day.
Yeah. I said g'day. He was scared actually. He messaged me and said, can you just keep that weird bloke away from me and stop letting him tell me how to do my ruck taps? It was weird.
I said, Jolly, Jolly. And I kind of did a ruck tap wave.
Yeah, that's weird.
And he said,
please don't do that.
He said,
don't do that. G'day. Hey, moving
how
on.
You,
I want to get
said,
to the
how
Ned's
are you, man?
Level
how are you,
young
man?
Star here. We've got the Ned's level young star. This segment's gone by storm. The fans love this one. And this week, it's no different. Justin McInerney from the Swans, who's been a very good player for a long time, also close to our home, is a Northern Eye boy.
He's a Banyule boy.
So he's a Northern region, and we absolutely love that. But he's playing some incredible footy. So classy, so clean. Wingman, really links up with the chains. But one thing about Justin, I think, actually, in his debut, which is big to come back, I think he might have had nearly donuts or one or two touches, but now he's just an absolute ball magnet. And we saw Kate Simpson have that in his first career, and he's gone on to be a very good player, so it might be a good sign.
Jonathan Brown might have only had one.
Yeah.
It's a test, though, isn't it? Because you'd be so down on yourself.
It is.
How many do you have? How many do you have?
I had, I think, like four. I got dropped the next week.
Four's
but, yeah, kicked one of the best
four's
goals
okay.
of all
Keeps
time.
You coming
actually,
back.
The quickest goal it's ever been kicked. So,
stop speaking over me, or we might bring Tomo Sorry. Back. But you are in really good form. We're in so-so form as a pairing, but we'll improve. Hey, lots more coming up. Goal kicking. It's been Scheisenhausen, the worst month ever. We're going to get to the bottom of that after the break. Teams on 10 is proudly brought to you by Firthy Refreshing Ale. Unbelievable. Yes, welcome back to Teams on 10. Well, the Clarko news is big news, Dilly, and everyone's got a theory at the moment, and you've got a bit of an oddball one.
Huge news. Well, he's contracted to 2023, I think it is, and everyone thinks that if he's not at Hawthorn, there's three clubs, Gold Coast, Carlton and Collingwood, that he could end up at.
Yep.
I would not be surprised if there's a mother deal from another club involved in this. When the best coach of the modern generation is up for grabs, there's going to be more than three clubs having a look. I think there's three clubs there that are in contention that won't be looking, but everyone is going to be asking the question, is Clarko available? I would not be surprised if someone jumped up out of nowhere, like a Lance Franklin to the Giants, then he ends up at Sydney. No one knew about it. Watch this space. I'm very excited for this.
Not a bad position for Clarko to be in, really, is it?
He could name
everyone wanting to just have a dance with you.
He could name his club. I reckon he could go there.
Just quickly, the Mitchell scenario, Hawthorn have tried to be warm and fuzzy with it. They've effectively said, you're out, haven't they? It's a big move by Hawthorn.
It's strange. Sam Mitch, from all reports, is an absolutely incredible coach.
Yeah.
And I know he and Clarko have an incredible relationship, which would be respected no matter what. But it is going to be interesting to see how that transition takes over. You know, we saw what happened with Mulethouse and Buckley. It didn't quite work as well as what we hoped. But I think just to harp on about this, he's taking over Hawthorn in a bit of a different position to what Buckley did at Collingwood. They were a premiership team, grand final team. Buckley took over. This one, the Hawks are sort of at that rebuilding stage. So I think you'll get a bit more leeway if he takes it over from there.
It is going to dominate the footy media for the rest of the year. And good luck to Clarko. He will be coaching somewhere in the near future because he's a star and so is his daughter. So g'day, Steph. If you're watching, I don't know why I'm doing a cheerio,
but we
can do that. I'm not a big stat man. Okay, I don't really like stats. I'm more a feel guy when I watch my footy and consume my footy.
Yeah.
But a stat came across my desk that did make me sort of sit up straight.
Yeah. Who's putting stats across your desk?
I do. I get emailed them. I've got a couple of people working for me.
Yeah, yeah.
The last month has been the worst in the history of the game for goal kicking accuracy. And that in this modern era of you get 1,000 massages and Pilates and professional footy blew me away. What's your reaction to that?
No, that honestly really does surprise me as well. Look, I don't think it's ever really been good in the modern game as we know. There's always a half one about goal kicking. It is tough because I don't really care what anyone says. The players are definitely more fatigued in the modern game than they were 20, 30 years ago when they're having set shots for goal. It's a lot quicker. But I really can't put a pinpoint on what this is. It's goal kicking is momentum and it's confidence.
Yep.
And whether it's actually quite contagious as well. So if your teammate misses, then you miss. It does stuff you up, and you know you can see teams, if they don't kick goals straight away, you do get the jitters. But I can't put my finger on what it would be, but I don't think they are practising enough.
Luke Bruce is one of the best in the business. He's one of the players where he just looks confident every time he has a shot. I caught up with him a couple of days ago and asked him about goal kicking and how important it is.
The little man on the shoulder certainly does some talking. To me, it does talking to nearly every player in the competition, and that's why goal kicking can be a very hard part of the game. It's such an isolated skill that fortunately for me, I get a lot on either on the run or I get to snap or things like that. But those ones where they are isolated in a set shot scenario can be quite difficult, especially the ones where everyone thinks he'll kick this. He's going to kick this. That they're, for me, are probably the toughest ones.
There's one of the best, Luke Bruce. This is my bugbear with it. And we've been butchering up the golf course and we're about to see that. Golfers spend a lot of time putting. You've been a league footballer for 7 or 8 years. How much time of the week did you spend on your goal kicking?
Not a lot. And the thing with that is, but the key forwards do spend a lot of time after training. And believe it or not, Levi Casbot stays out for an hour each session doing nearly 100 shots a goal. But the thing with goal kicking that happens is it only really comes to a head when you're not in form with goal kicking. It's not something that's built in consistently. It'll be brought up at training when you have a bad week and you do it. So it's really got to be something consistent that goes through, that's for sure.
Everyone must have a routine, though. I hope I'm not breaching confidence here, that you've played with guys that don't have a goal-kicking routine. Yeah. That's ridiculous in this modern time. It can cost grand finals.
Yeah, no, you're right. Like at the Giants and both Carlton, we'd go through routines, but some players really didn't have a routine that they stuck with. And the thing is as well, Nick, is if you have a routine and you don't do it, then there's no point in having a routine. So if you've got a routine, you've got to be practising it a lot. And a lot of these guys didn't practise a lot, so why would you have a routine if you're not going to be actually doing it?
Fair enough. I'm not sure we got to the bottom of that, but I think the lesson is have a routine and practise it. The players should be doing hours a week if you're serious about your goal kicking. Or am I a dinosaur?
You're a dinosaur, but you're still right. I think you're correct. But in saying that as well, it is a tough skill. And match day is different. You're fatigued, but I think having a routine, we've got to the bottom of it. You've got to have one.
Okay, very easy for us to say because we did some goal kicking last year and we were butchering the footy everywhere, but we hadn't had a kick for a while.
It's very easy on the couch to talk about.
Now, moving into high-level performance, that was not us in the old Ned's adventure. We had installment one last week at the golf course. You were on top, but from memory, I was getting in the flow zone and I was thinking, hold on, Dilly boy, I'm coming. Here's installment two.
Score stands at 2 to Dill, none to Nick at the moment, but we're about to have a longest drive challenge. Now, this is where Nick might just come into his own. The big hitter, he's got the big frame. We're hoping for a big result here for Nick.
I can't hit it straight.
All right, mate, it's okay. Don't be giving your head.
Now, if you did blink, you may have missed that. Let's have one more quick look where that went.
Oh, I've got an air. That's a swing. That's just the old Greg Norman, mate. That's just a practice swing. Ah! Mulligan.
Now, despite Nick not having the best drive there, he still managed to do better than Dill onto the chipping contest.
Oh, yeah.
There is a chance I could get defeated by that. Chip and run, Butler, mate.
Now, we've had to go to the measuring tapes again here, and after some careful measuring, Nick has managed to pip Dill here on the chipping contest. Now, it's on to stroke play on a par 3 to see who the winner will be.
Short. That is short.
Jeez, it's nice. Long walk to the green with the putter.
Little shit you are. Oh, hey, the challenge might be on here. That's clutch-ish.
Stop.
Oh, that was clutch. Yeah, that was clutch.
Surprising as it may seem, we've had another draw, so we've had to controversially find another par 3 so the guys can have another crack.
No.
Oh, that's nice. Keep coming, keep coming. What the f***? I'm actually sick of this game. This is to win, you know.
And there you have it. Butler takes the title.
Here you go, mate.
So there you have it. Our two old mates here have managed to turn the gentleman's game into anything but. Moving Nick now up to 2 points to Dill's three in the totals. Now, the big thing is Ned's Adventures. We're on the move again next week. Where we'll be? Well, we haven't quite figured that part out yet, but tune in.
Yes, the old Ned's Adventures going viral. A win for me, which is good for sport. It's good for humanity. And you were good. I think our viewers will find that interesting.
That was good. That was my favourite one.
Yeah.
And so, I lost.
Oh, that's okay. Yeah. So that was very enjoyable, and it came down to the end, and I was very clutch. I just want to give you a bit of mentoring in your TV, because you're going very well in your TV. Mm. I've said before, you are naturally funny, and people like you, and you're a millennial, and you're popular, and you don't have to try too hard. Mm-hmm. So you shouldn't
do... So you're trying to take some of those notes?
No, you shouldn't do scripted funny, and this is why.
What sort of hole we got here, horse? Oh.
Okay, up to the seat.
You go first.
What is this? Mate, is this honestly your club? How small are you?
Oh, my God. That, you got to hit that. Oh, that's your club, you got to play it.
Oh, my God. I almost did my back.
It's my kids' club.
Careful. Oh, shit. What's that?
That's disrespectful.
See, that's not funny.
You always
break
things.
You cut that stuff out of your repertoire.
Yeah,
you just don't have to try too hard. I don't think our viewers like that. DM us if you want more of that rubbish, but I don't know if it's your go.
Poor Woody.
Leave the funny stuff.
Well, you leave disrespectful, man.
Leave the funny stuff to me.
Yeah, no, I will leave that to you. You're very funny.
The scripted funny. We need to straighten up. Stay around for more Ned's Adventures next week. But before that, Jack Sinclair, he's got a ripping mullet. He looks a bit like Billy Ray Cyrus, and he's playing good footy. He's next. Teams on 10 is brought to you by Neds. Take it to the Neds level. Yes, welcome back to Teams on 10. Well, the Saints have had their mojo come back in the last couple of weeks, but our guest here never really lost his. Jack Sinclair, your year has been fantastic. Your feathers are fantastic. And great to have you on the show.
Ah, thanks for having me. Yeah, something different with the hair. thought I'd mix it up after a number of years with the same haircut. And, yeah, I don't know, seems to be going okay.
It does. We'll touch on the hair in a minute. First of all, the Saints. I touched on it there. The spirit and the connection has come back in the last couple of weeks. The Saints supporters are excited again.
Yeah, it has a little bit. Tough start to the year. A few big losses, but, yeah, we've seen to have bounced back after the bye and... been playing some really good footy and hopefully can continue again this weekend.
How'd you get it back? Is there a simple answer to that or did it just happen?
I think it was a process of a number of weeks, lots of conversations far away up in Sydney, talking about the way we wanted to defend and, sort of our approach to the contest, which really fell away in games. And, we had heaps of goals kicked against us many times, so it was tough playing in the back line while that was happening. And then probably just the bye, good chance to freshen up and, everyone to get away and... Yeah, sort of recharge your batteries, I guess.
It's a funny game, isn't it? Because we were just chatting off-air before. You publicly probably get a lot of pressure put on the Saints because you're not performing, but realistically, you're only one game out of the eight and it can change so quickly. Is that like the messaging that keeps coming forward?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, if we play well, that stuff sort of takes care of itself in terms of where we finish on the ladder. But, for us, it's more just about being consistent quarter to quarter, something we really haven't shown that much this year. Since the bye, we've been playing pretty well. Dropped off a little bit on the weekend in the last quarter, but if we just sort of stick to what we've been doing the last couple of weeks, you never really know what can happen.
We were chatting earlier about goal kicking. I'm not sure if you're aware. It's been the worst month in AFL history, right, Nick?
That's what the stats say.
That's the stats say in goal kicking. What's it like in an AFL club now? When I was there, I don't really remember doing a whole lot, only if we missed a lot of goals that week. What's your goal routine? Do you have one? And how much are you practising that?
Playing in the back line this year, probably haven't practised it a lot.
I used to knock him over at halfback as well, though.
Yeah. Probably more on the run, I guess. I think I've had one set shot this year and I nailed it, but show the forwards how it's done. But look, our forwards are always practising. We've got Jared Ruffhead down there now, and you know, I think everyone has a routine. I've sort of got a rough one. Sort of go back, put the ball on the ground, throw the grass up. Probably still do it indoors. I don't know, it's a bit of a habit.
Yeah.
But, for me, rough routine, but it's more just about sort of being relaxed and trying to narrow your focus, I guess, because there are a lot of pressure. Like, the game's so fast, you know, you barely have time to make a decision, and then all of a sudden you've got 30 seconds to think about your set shot, so it can be pretty tough for some guys.
It is incredible, though, isn't it, Nick? Like, we AFL, you train so much on all these things, but really, at the end of the day, goal kicking is the number one thing. More goals, win games. There was a game earlier in the year, I can't remember what it was against, with the Saints, but you probably missed the first four or five and kicked points. And I remember Rats's face just going, because it does suck the momentum out of it if you don't, don't hit them.
Yeah, no, it does. I think that was probably the Geelong game. We played really well and we ended up losing by a few goals, but I think all the stats were in our favour, but we just couldn't finish in front of goal. It's contagious. Like, if a few guys miss and then the crowd starts getting into it, and it can be pretty tough.
Mm. Your own year, it's been a beauty. You've gone to half back, you're dashing, you're kicking long, your stats on paper are fantastic, and you seem to be consistently playing great footy. It must feel great to be at that level.
Yeah, it feels good. Last year was pretty tough. Missed the first seven games, emergency for everyone. So sort of wondering where I was going to slot into the team. Played probably mostly midfield last year. New role this year, it's been pretty exciting. Been on the end of a few hidings though, and it's sort of been tough at times, but overall, been pretty enjoyable.
Do you get comfortable, like, in that position? I suppose you've, as you said then, you were out of the team for 7 weeks in a row. You're playing incredible footy now, but what's that mindset like? Do you still play on the edge, or are you comfortable in the team?
I'll probably still on the edge a bit. I've never really felt, like, super safe in terms of, like, my spot in the team. And every year is different. Like, you know, we've had so many recruits come in over the years, so I feel like I've continually had to sort of prove myself and, improve and, play a whole different bunch of positions to sort of find my spot in the team. And, this year it's sort of probably been easier than the others.
One more footy one before we get a bit loose. You wear the Banger Harvey 35. Does that bring pressure? Or I'd be intimidated, I reckon.
I don't know. It's funny, on the weekend I was in the goal square defensively for the first time ever. I don't know why, but... at the centre bounce, and someone yelled out to me, "Oh, you're a poor man's Robert Harvey."
I said,
obviously, 383 games, couple Brownlows, like, that's, I don't know, it's a compliment to me.
Yeah.
But, I wanted to play for the Saints my whole life, and, I used to love him growing up, so I was, super, super excited when they gave me his number.
You didn't start at 35, though, did you?
No, 40? I wore 40 for the first 2 years,
Well, you're a confident lad and very articulate, and I was thinking you must have done a bit of TV before. Every time you interview, you do it well. So I went back through the archives and found you did a bit of loose stuff a year or two ago on the old Lobo show. I don't know what happened to the Lobo show, but I think it was one good commercial deal from taking off. Talk us through this sort of weirdness.
Yeah, it was basically a whole bunch of questions, I think, themed around finals footy.
Oh, look, you're giving it to Lobo.
And, you know, the Saints haven't played a lot of finals, so my knowledge was quite limited. And, I seemed to be on the end of pretty much all the food there. I think I got one question right out of maybe four or five. That wasn't a lot of fun.
It looked like a very good production. Now, our good friends here at Furphy, they're all about the Furphy unbelievable tale, and I'm tipping you've got a story or two you can let us in on.
Yeah, well, thinking about my school sporting days, actually played a fair bit of cricket growing up, and I think I remember one day playing against St. Kevin's out near the zoo there. I scored 8 runs off one ball. So I hit one down a third man, I think, for 2 runs. And then the guy who threw it in threw it short of the stumps and actually hit the wicketkeeper's helmet. So that's another 5.
Yeah, that's a 5.
And then it's ricocheted off and we've run another one. So probably standing there for about 5 minutes while the scorers are trying to work out what was going on.
So what did you end up with that day?
Oh, I don't know, maybe 20 or 30 or something. But I say that it was my first ball, so a strike rate at 800.
That's pretty impressive.
After one
very.
It's not a bad furphy. Hey, well, mate, we're going to keep you in for the tips, but before that, you don't make the trip into the Como and come away empty-handed.
He actually said this, sorry, before that he only came in for the Magic Hand car wash.
Did he?
Yeah.
No, that's not true. Look, he's happy and healthy.
He did say that.
It is, it is the finest prize pack in footy. So I'll roll through them now. You do get the one-year unlimited wash club membership thanks to Magic Hand car wash. Magic wash clubs cleaner, safer and faster. A power drill thanks to Icon Construction. A new Icon. You look like a tradie. A $50 breakfast voucher at Cheeky Monkey Cafe on Swan Street. A 101 Pilates session at Motion Health Toorak. A slab of Furphy refreshing ale. The Neighbours Cellar Shiraz. And some Smash It hair product for the Billy Ray Cyrus feathers. How good?
Yeah, doesn't get any better, does it?
There you go. So good luck against the Lions on the weekend. And stay for the tips, Jackie boy. So we'll roll on with it, Dilly. Port v Melbourne, Thursday night.
Melbourne will bounce back this week.
Ben Brown in.
Yeah, that's big.
Okay.
Who's he coming for? Is that just...
A small.
Okay, cool.
Tall for small.
Sweet.
Essendon, Adelaide.
Essendon.
Thoughts, Jackie?
Yeah, I think Essendon should get the job done. The Crows have been okay, pretty competitive.
And that shows how quick it can change, doesn't it? Like Essendon, they were pretty crap.
Now
Very good. Hawthorn, Freo. A bit about this game with the Clarkson news.
I'll say Fremantle.
I think the Hawks will win.
Yeah, I like it. Good. Carlton, Geelong at the G.
Geelong.
Cats.
Brisbane, St Kilda, Dylan.
I'm going the Saints, obviously. They will dominate this week. Halfback will get a lot of work there with Jackie down there. He'll be moving very cleanly.
Ew, the mojo has returned. GWS and the Gold Coast at Ballarat.
That is going to have about four people at that game, I feel.
Maybe.
Yeah, I think the Giants, I think the Giants will win.
Jackie?
Yeah, I think the Giants do.
Dogs, Swans, big game.
Dogs.
Tigers, Pies, Sunday twilight.
Tigers for me.
Yeah, I think the Tigers.
Still win the flag?
Yes.
Yeah, I reckon. I think they'll get it going the back half of the year, like they seem to always do.
Yeah, I reckon you're right. And the Roos and the Eagles, Monday night football to finish.
The Kangaroos. The Eagles are really struggling at the moment.
They are. That's an upset. Chance, the Roos?
I think the Eagles probably bounce back. Okay.
There we go. Hey, good tippy. Good discussion. You be quiet. I'm thanking Jack. Yeah. Hey, that was Teams on 10. Hope you enjoyed it. We're a bit rusty, but we had some good moments. See you next week.
Oh, my God.